Arawali's head and face belong to the representative of a high type of civilization, although her dress is that of a savage. Poor Arawali, she is one of a tribe of cannibals, but strangely enough, she herself has never tasted long pig, the euphemistic name applied by the natives to human flesh. In her hand she carries a fan, the ornamentation of which is the royal escutcheon of Mu, the Empire of the Sun. No ancient record has ever been found that mentions savagery as existing on any spot of the Earth's surface prior to the destruction of Mu. Then why did such magnificent specimens of man as the forefathers of the South Sea Islanders become degraded cannibals? Our story of the great calamity that overtook the first race of man answers this question. Bird symbols of the Creator. Birds are symbols of the creative attribute of the deity, appear to have been the most prominent symbol for the creative forces among the people who inhabited the northeastern parts of the motherland. The bird symbol extended south as far as where Hawaii now stands, and perhaps farther. Without question, it was held as a sacred symbol among all people of the motherland, although among some not the favored creative symbol. There are many records about sacred birds in all Oriental countries, in Egypt, Babylonia, and ancient Mexico, as shown by Niven's Mexican stone tablets, and today it is much alive among the North American Indians, who call it the Thunderbird. The Indian legend says that lightning is the blinking of the Thunderbird's eyes, and thunder is the flapping of its wings. Also, that rain comes from a lake situated in the middle of the back of the Thunderbird. Niven's Mexican bird tablets. Among Niven's collection of 2,600 ancient stone tablets, there are about 30 containing birds. I have selected three as being representative of the whole 30. These birds are all symbols of the Creator, as told by the writing on them, the Old Temple esoteric numeral writing. They were drawn by some unknown Uyghur people, as the Uyghur form of numerals, lines, or bars is used. This is confirmed by the eyes, which are the Uyghur pattern of the picture of the sun and the monotheistic symbol of the deity. The central figure, number 1086, is holding the hieratic letter H, the alphabetical symbol of the creative forces. In Hawaii, there is a legend that a big bird from on high came down and laid an egg in the sea. The egg burst and Hawaii came forth. So that from this we may infer that the bird symbol for the Creator was used by the ancient Hawaiians. Seb, the Egyptian bird, among the Egyptian pantheon we find one of the gods named after a bird, a goose. The goose is the sacred bird mentioned in Oriental legends. Upper Egypt was colonized from India. Seb was called the father of the gods, the bearer of the gods, etc. Seb is the Egyptian name for a certain species of goose which was worn as a symbol on his headdress. Seb was also called the great cackler, which produced the mundane egg out of which the earth was produced. Therefore the human body also. It is written, I protect the egg of the great cackler. If I thrive, it thrives. If I live, it lives. If I breathe the breath of air, it breathes. Book of the Dead. It here also clearly shows that the bird Seb was a symbol of the creative forces, the great primary four. A North American Indian tableau depicting the destruction of Mu. This tableau comes from the Nootka Indians who live on the west coast of Vancouver Island, British Columbia, Canada. While there are scores, yes, hundreds of writings telling of Mu and her destruction, and various compound symbols forming vignettes in the ancient Maya writings, such as the Troano manuscript, the Borgian Codex, the Codex Corticianus, throughout the world I have only found two tableaus or pictures showing the manner of her destruction. First the Egyptian, and now this North American Indian. There is, however, a marked difference in the two. The Egyptian depicts Mu falling into an abyss of fire. The North American Indian tells of the waters flowing in over her and submerging her, two phases of the general description of her destruction, so that both the Egyptian and the North American Indian are shown to be correct. Although these two peoples are so widely separated on the Earth's surface now, at that time both knew the scientific cause of Mu's destruction. Many of the symbols forming this Indian tableau are identical with those in Mu, while others are not so familiar. The most prominent change from the general writings of Mu is in the symbol used by the Indians for symbolizing the waters. In the Naga, Uyghur, Carian, American Maya, etc., an unadorned serpent was used called Kanab, its body generally shown in wavy lines like the rolls of the ocean swell. These old Indians, however, have done their southern neighbors one better. They have divided the waters, using the biggest of fishes to symbolize oceans and the wavy serpent line to symbolize lesser waters. They call their symbol for the oceans the killer whale. This symbol is found among many of the Northwest Indian tribes, if not all. Therefore, it had a common origin among them. It was probably designated the killer on account of its having swept over and drowned so many millions of the people of Mu. The tableau is divided into three figures, a serpent, a bird, and a fish. Top, the serpent. This serpent has a plume of feathers on its head. It is therefore an adorned serpent. It is a conventional drawing of Quetzalcoatl, the feathered serpent of the northern people of the motherland. An adorned serpent has always been the symbol among all ancient peoples for the deity as the creator and his creations. The seven commands as given in the books of the Golden Age. In the center of the picture is a conventional bird which the Indians call the Thunderbird. Thunderbird legends permeate the legends of Indians of the Northwest. In Mu, I find birds were used in the northern parts to symbolize the sacred four, the four great primary and creative forces, the executors of the Creator's seven great commands. The use of these bird symbols must have been quite extensive in the motherland, as we find their reflection in Hawaii, Pacific Ocean, Niven's tablets, Mexico, the Egyptian god Seb, and also throughout the Orient. In addition to birds, crosses were used to symbolize the sacred four. Judging by what has come to light, crosses were universally used. As far back as 70,000 years ago, the plain cross appears in the sacred writings as the symbol of the four creative forces. Bottom, third figure, is a large fish, a conventional whale, the killer whale. The North American Indians are the only people I have found who use a fish to symbolize water, and yet it is a most natural symbol. The wonder to me is that it did not become as prominent among all people. The Thunderbird symbolizing the great forces is depicted as standing on the whale, which is the ocean waters, with its claws embedded in the whale's back, showing that the waters are in the grip and under control of the forces. The whale, the ocean waters, is dead, quiescent, as its neck has been broken by the forces. Therefore, it can kill no more. The tragedy has been accomplished. This is shown by magnetic forces falling from the wings of the Thunderbird and forming an abyss. Number 1. The eye of the whale is formed by two squares, one within the other, and a third solid square forming the pupil. The two line squares symbolize mother and land, i.e. motherland. The solid black square, the pupil, symbolizes darkness. No sun shines upon her. This, in combination with the broken neck and the abyss being carried into it, reads, "The motherland has been carried down into the abyss of darkness." In Niven's Mexican tablet number 1430, an exact counterpart of this eye is seen. From now on, the reading is easy. I have only to deal with the symbols in common use in the motherland and most of her colonies. Number 2, through the mouth of the whale, water is shown as carrying down something to the throat. Number 3, at the end of the mouth is a throat with the passage showing near the center. Beyond the throat is the symbol, number 4, the hieratic letter U of the motherland's alphabet. The esoteric meaning of this letter is an abyss. We now see that the motherland is carried down into a watery abyss, submerged. Number 5, directly beyond the abyss come four bars, one of the motherland's forms of writing numerals. Thus, four bars meant the numeral 4. 4 was the numeral symbol of the sacred 4, the four great creative forces. Number 6. On the backbone of the fish are four discs, another popular form of writing the numeral 4. Number 7. Above the backbone are shown five bars, the numeral 5, the symbol of the full godhead of 5, the creator and his four great creative forces. This tableau asserts that the motherland was destroyed indirectly through the four great forces, a fact mentioned in all writings about the destruction of Mu. Legend: the creator desired the destruction of the motherland of man. The four great forces, the executor of the creator's commands, caused the lands to go down and the waters to cover them over. They went down into a watery abyss and were submerged. In addition to the writings on the Nevada stones about Mu, we have here a purely American account of her destruction. Truly, our Western America has more records of the very ancient past than all the rest of the world put together. These American records are hoary with age. An Alaskan totem pole. This totem pole comes from the Haiden Indians of Queen Charlotte Islands, Alaska. The tribe is known as Quamacolas. One of the old chiefs explained the symbols on this pole as follows. The winged creature that crowns the pole is the Thunderbird, the representative of the Creator. Lightning is the winking of the Thunderbird's sharp eyes, and thunder is the flapping of its wings. Rain is the spilling of water from a huge lake in the middle of his immense back. The talons of the Thunderbird are fastened in the tail of the killer whale. The Haiden chief, the oldest living member of the tribe, explained, "In the days of the great flood, the steel-headed man was the leader of all men, and much beloved by the Thunderbird, the Thunder God, and all the other gods. When this great flood swept over the face of the earth, the gods feared for the life of the steel-headed man, whom they miraculously changed into a steel-headed salmon. During the days of the flood, the transformed leader of men lived in the waters of the Nimbkish River. He gathered the posts and the timbers for his dwelling, but found he lacked strength to do the building. Then the Thunderbird appeared before the steel-headed man in a great crashing and rumbling of thunder. The Thunderbird lifted his god mask and revealed a human face to the steel-headed man. 'I am as human as you,' said the bird, 'and I will put up the timbers for you. Here shall I stay with you to set up your tribe and be your protector forever.' Then with the four claps of thunder, the bird caused to appear a group of warriors who sprang out of the crashing din full armored. They, with the steel-headed man, were the nucleus from which the Haiden people grew. The other symbols on this totem pole tell the story of the warrior princess, a double-headed monster of the sea, and a legend of the whale and sea lion. The whale and sea lion. The sea lion was helping a warrior to save his wife from the killer whale drowning when he was overcome and struck down himself by the killer whale. He was saved and restored to his family by Colas, the protecting god of the household. The sea lion was made a member of the tribe and married the warrior princess, the daughter of the steel-headed man. Note, the Algonquin Indians have a tradition as told by John Ballou in his Oaspe about the flood and the submersion of Mu, called Pan. As related in this book, the tradition is actually two traditions in one. The Algonquin Indians had a warning of the flood and were building ships in which to escape. 138 ships of the deluge set out from the continent of Pan. Attached to and directly following this is, in the same day the gates of heaven and earth were opened, and the earth rocked to and fro as a ship at sea, and the rains fell in torrents, and loud thunderings, earthquakes, came up from beneath the floor of the world, and the vortex of the earth closed in from the extreme, and lo, the earth was broken. A mighty continent was cut loose from its fastenings, and the fires of the earth came forth in flames and clouds with loud roarings, and the land rocked to and fro like a ship at sea. And again the vortex of the earth is about on all sides, and by the pressure the land sank down beneath the waters to rise no more." Chapter 4. Records of the Lost Continent. The records referring to the land of Mu are many and various. Among written records are some that tell us man made his advent on earth in the land of Mu, the Nakhal tablets, for instance. Other records give us the geographical position of the lost continent. The American written records, which are many, tell us the land of Mu lay to the west of America. The Asiatic records all say Mu, the motherland, lay to the east of Asia, towards the rising sun. Therefore, the motherland of man, being between America and Asia, lay in the Pacific Ocean, and on the islands we find stone remains of her great cities and temples, and also a white race. I shall first take the American written records, commencing with the Troano manuscript, an ancient Maya book written in Yucatan. It has been estimated to be from 1500 to 5000 years old. It is, I think, between 1500 and 3000 years old. I base this on the form of its writing. Several extracts from the Troano manuscript that I here present will conclusively prove the correctness of my contention regarding Mu. Extract 1. In the year 6, Khan, on the 11th Muluk in the month of Zak, where occurred terrific earthquakes, which continued until the 13th of Chuen, without interruption, the country of the hills of earth, the land of Mu, was sacrificed, twice upheaved. It disappeared during the night, having been constantly shaken by the fires of the underneath. Being confined, these causes the land to rise and to sink several times in various places. At last the surface gave way, and the 10 countries or tribes were borne asunder and scattered. They sank with their 64 million inhabitants 8,060 years before the writing of this book. Geologically, the description, the country of the hills of earth, is absolutely correct and accounts for the quarries that are to be found on Easter Island. Extract 2. The birthplace of the sacred mysteries, Mu, the lands of the west, that land of Kui, the motherland of the gods. 1. Is one of the letters M in the hieratical alphabet of Mu, and is here alphabetical symbol, thus we have Mu. 2. Is one of the letters T in the hieratical alphabet, and often used as the word the in the spoken language. 3. Is the universal geographical symbol for the lands of the West. The characters being in block designate the past tense, thus Mu was the lands of the West. 1. That. 2. Land of Kui or Kui land. 3. Lands of the West. The lands of the West were the land of Kui. This extract is the most important known passage referring to the motherland of man, for it has already been shown that the geographical name of the motherland of man was the lands of the West, and as the Troano manuscript was written in America, it also shows that the lands of the West lay to the west of America. Many records will be brought forward confirming the fact that the motherland of man lay to the west of America. The land of Kui means the land of departed souls. The Egyptian Ka, with its extended meaning, comes out of the Maya Kui. In ancient times, God did not mean the deity. It referred to the soul of a departed one. Thus, the motherland of the gods, mentioned in the manuscript, means, by extension, the motherland of man. Sir Gardner Wilkinson, the great Egyptologist, in his book Manners and Customs, Volume 3, page 70, says, Kui land, or the land of Kui, according to the Mayan language, was the birthplace of the goddess Maya, the mother of the gods, and of man. Extract 2, by the way, is corroborated many times in the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Codex Corticianus. The Codex Corticianus is another of the old Maya books that escaped the eyes of the fanatical Bishop Landa. This book is now in the National Museum of Madrid. The characters, figures, and writings would indicate that it is of about the same age as the Troano manuscript. The language of the Codex Corticianus, however, is much more symbolical than that of the Troano manuscript. Here are some extracts from it bearing on our subject. By his strong arm, Homan caused the earth to tremble after sunset, and during the night, Mu, the country of the hills of earth, was submerged. Mu, the life of the basin, seas, was submerged by Homan during the night. The place of the dead ruler is now lifeless. It moves no more. After having twice jumped from its foundations, the king of the deep, while forcing his way out, has shaken it up and down, has killed it, has submerged it. Twice Mu jumped from her foundations. It was then sacrificed by fire. It burst while being shaken up and down violently by earthquakes. By kicking it, the wizard that makes all things move like a mass of worms sacrificed it that very night. It is self-evident that both the Codex Corticianus and the Troano manuscript were written from the same temple record. The Codex Corticianus gives the land its hieratical name only, while the Troano manuscript gives both its hieratical and geographical names. The Lhasa record. This record was discovered by Schliemann in the old Buddhist temple of Lhasa, Tibet. Schliemann deciphered and translated it. It evidently does not come from the same original record as do the Troano manuscript and the Codex Corticianus. It is more modern and is not written in Maya characters. Here is an interesting extract from the Lhasa record. When the star of Baal fell on the place where now is only the sky and the sea, the seven cities with their golden gates and transparent temples quivered and shook like the leaves in a storm. And behold, a flood of fire and smoke arose from the palaces. Agonies and cries of the multitude filled the air. They sought refuge in their temples and citadels. And the wise Mu, the hieratic Ra Mu, arose and said to them, "Did I not predict all this?" And the women and the men, in their precious stones and shining garments, lamented, "Mu, save us." And Mu replied, "You shall all die together with your servants and your riches, and from your ashes new nations shall rise. If they forget they are superior not because of what they put on, but what they put out, the same will befall them." Flames and smoke choked the words of Mu. The land and its inhabitants were torn to pieces and swallowed up by the depths. Baal is a Maya word meaning Lord of the Fields. Transparent temples is without doubt a mistranslation. These temples were not built of glass or any other transparent substance. They were open or roofless temples, so constructed that the rays of Ra, the sun, could fall upon the heads of those who were in prayer and supplication within the temple, like the Parsi temples of today. Le Plungyun found records in Yucatan saying that the hieratic head of the land of Mu prophesied its destruction and that some, heeding the prophecy, left and went to the colonies where they were saved. Le Plungyun's death occurred many years before Schliemann published the Lhasa record. Uxmal Temple. This temple is situated at Uxmal, Yucatan, and has been named by Le Plungyun the Temple of Sacred Mysteries. On its walls there is an important inscription which reads, "This edifice is a commemorative monument dedicated to the memory of the M, the lands of the West, that land of Kui, the birthplace of our sacred mysteries." This temple is built facing west where the motherland once stood. The inscription quoted is a full corroboration of the second extract from the Troano manuscript and confirms other records which state that the motherland lay to the west of America. Further, and this is most important, it tells us that the religious teachings of this temple came from there, so that whatever we find here we know originated in Mu, the lands of the West. With this information, we can trace the Egyptian religion and learning back to its source. Xochicalco Pyramid, Mexico. This pyramid is situated 60 miles southwest of Mexico City and antedates all of the Egyptian pyramids by thousands of years. One facade of the pyramid shows inscriptions in the form of a pictorial tableau, which is divided into two sections. The upper, or may I call it the cornice, relates how the destruction of Mu, the lands of the West, occurred, and what forces were active in her destruction, also the origin of these forces. The great part of this section of the tableau has been lost by falling of stones, and some of what remain are so weathered and broken as to be unreadable. Therefore I shall not attempt to give the exact legend, but rather the import of it only. The lower and main part of the tableau is in fairly good condition for reading, although many parts are too weathered to get all of the details. We can, however, give a general deciphering, but with many details left out. Part 1, the cornice. Part 1, the cornice. 1, an elongated square, the hieratic letter M, alphabetical symbol of Mu, the motherland. On one side are two scallops, the two islands which, with Mu, made up the lands of the West. 2, volcanic forces working within and underneath Mu, tearing her to pieces. 3, the Maya Tian Chihan symbol of the four great primary forces, shown as coming direct from the infinite, his command, desire, order, etc. 4. The head or point of an arrow, spear, or javelin, the symbol showing the forces are active. Through the spearhead is a line dividing it, the symbol showing that it is not one of the primary forces, but a subsidiary coming out of a primary. This is a compound symbol dividable as follows. A. Elongated square symbol of Mu. B. The four pillars surrounding her. C. The forces have caused the pillars to give way, and Mu is being carried down. 6. A human figure denoting that human beings went down with the land. Part 2. The submersion. 1A. A conventional serpent, symbol of the great waters. It is coiled in the shape of the hieratic letter U, symbol of an abyss of water. Part 2. The submersion. 1B. The eyes of the serpent are closed. Being closed, they symbolize sleep, rest. The waters are at rest, having found their own level. 2. The numeral 3, Mu's numeral symbol. 3. One of the symbols for the lands of the west, being below the surface, cuts 2 and 3, say, Mu, the lands of the west, has been submerged. 4. The tail of the serpent, the waters, is curved towards the down, embracing in its coil a human figure, saying that the inhabitants went down with the land. There are other details in this tableau, but they are in too poor a condition to warrant an attempt at reading. Supplementing the foregoing with other inscriptions on this pyramid, I will give its legend. Legend. This pyramid is erected as a monument to Mu, the motherland of man, the lands of the west, to commemorate her memory and her destruction with all mankind thereon. The pillars that support her were attacked by great forces. They gave way. Then Mu and all her people sank into the watery abyss. Plato's Timaeus says that this Mexican pyramid is an exact model of the sacred hill of Atlantis on which was built the Temple of Poseidon. Plato lived 400 BC, and yet we are being taught that Columbus discovered America. Akkad Zib, in the city of Chichen Itza, there is a slab which forms the lintel of the door of the inner chamber. At the southern end of the building called Akkad Zib, there we have the awful, the tenebrous record. This slab is a description of the lands of the west being shaken to their foundations by earthquakes and then engulfed. Maya beliefs. The Mayas of Yucatan regarded the west as the region of darkness, the place where the souls of the dead return to the bosoms of their ancestors, as shown in Codex Cortesianus. Valmiki, Ramayana, Volume 1, page 342. The Maya adepts, the Nakals, starting from the land of their birth in the east, as missionaries of religion and learning, went first to Burma, and there taught the Nagas. From Burma they went to the Deccan in India, whence they carried their religion and learning to Babylonia and to Egypt. Burma, at Angkor Thom, Cambodia, may be seen conventional beasts that archaeologists have called lions. All are placed facing the east, looking toward the place where the motherland once stood. That their beasts refer to her, there can be no question, as they are saying Mu. This is shown by their conventional mouths, elongated squares, one of the forms of the letter M in the hieratic alphabet of Mu, and one of her symbols. Plutarch, Life of Solon. Sushis, the high priest of Sais, told Solon, 600 BC, also Psenophis, a priest of Heliopolis, that 9,000 years before, the relations of the Egyptians with the inhabitants of the lands of the west had been interrupted because of cataclysms destroying the intervening country, and the mud that had made the sea impassable since the destruction of Atlantis by earthquakes and submersion. It is here shown beyond controversy that the lands of the west were to the west of America, because America was the intervening lands that prevented travel to them when she was made impassable by cataclysms. Again, it is clearly established that neither Atlantis nor the intervening country was the lands of the west, nor was Atlantis the intervening land, because the intervening land was made impassable only while Atlantis was submerged. I shall next make a survey of the South Sea Islands and note the stone remains found on them, also the extraordinary and astounding legends found among the savages and semi-savages there. In going out on the Pacific Ocean from America, we shall be traveling west from America. The reader will kindly note that out on the Pacific Ocean we are west of Yucatan. Remembering this, it will enable him to appreciate certain records that hereafter appear. Among the specks of land forming the Polynesian and other groups, we shall find links that joined in prehistoric times the civilization of America with the civilizations of Southern and Eastern Asia, and eventually the various civilizations throughout the world. Although the journey is long, it will be interesting and full of astounding surprises, where we shall look for the remains of an ancient civilization, and where we shall find it will be on islands that within the memory of living man were inhabited by cannibalistic savages, many of which are cannibalistic to this day. Yet these cannibals, as I have shown, are the descendants of highly civilized peoples, the forefathers of the present Polynesians, now savages and semi-savages, were once the center of the Earth's civilization. Valmiki Ramayana, Volume 1, page 353. The Mayas were mighty navigators, whose ships traveled from the western to the eastern oceans, and from the southern to the northern seas, in ages so remote the sun had not yet risen above the horizon. That likewise, being learned architects, they built great cities and palaces. The great stone remains of the Pacific Islands. Throughout the length and breadth of the Pacific Ocean are scattered groups of small islands. On scores of them are the remains of a great civilization. There are great stone temples, cyclopean stone walls, stone-lined canals, stone-paved roads, and immense monoliths and statuary, works that required continental resources and workmen of skill. Yet we now find them not on a great continent, but on mere specks of land inhabited by savages and semi-savages. These great ruins appeal alike to layman and scientist as being the work of a great past civilization that existed ages ago, about which we know nothing. These remains are so many, so scattered, that in attempting to enumerate and describe them, it is hard to tell where to begin or how to end. It would require volumes instead of a few pages to describe them all. I can, therefore, give only a mere glance at what deserves a long and detailed study. The description will be popular, not technical. On many of the islands, the remains are so overrun with vegetation and covered up with soil that it is difficult to find them. I do not believe that one half are visible. They are simply overgrown mounds. Another difficulty with which the explorer has to contend is the savage inhabitants. They all have a superstitious dread of going near any of the great ruins. They believe them to be haunted by ghosts and evil spirits, which they call Maoli, so that it is next to impossible to get any of them to guide you to the ruins or even to tell where they are. A good way to discover their whereabouts, however, is to have a native show you over the island. But go your own way and do not follow him. Simply take him along to tell you the best road home. If you are approaching a ruin, he will try to make you go in an opposite direction. Should you persist in going on, when you get near the ruin, he will run away and leave you. Then you will know you are close to the object of your search. I shall make my start with the remains on Easter Island. They are better known than any of the others. Easter Island. Easter Island is situated at the southeastern extremity of Polynesia, 2,100 miles from the coast of South America. Its greatest length is 13 miles, and its greatest width 7 miles. On this little island there are at present, all told, 555 carved stones, colossal statues, as well as other examples of the art of a great prehistoric race. Easter Island Tablet. W.J. Thompson, whom I believe to be the best authority on what is found on Easter Island, says, "The largest image is in one of the quarries in an unfinished condition and measures 70 feet high in height. The smallest was one found in a cave and was found 3 feet long. The majority of them are from 15 to 18 feet high. It is supposed these images represent distinguished personages and are intended as monuments to their memory. The tops of some of these towering stones are capped with huge spheres, which show red in the distance. Many of them are carved from the red igneous rock forming the sides of the now silent volcanoes. One of these spheres, which is carved out of a red sandstone, measures 12 feet high in diameter. It is to be seen at the quarry at Terai Hills. Besides the statuary on Easter Island, there are several immense platform-like accumulations of cut and dressed stone. These piles are about 30 feet high and from 200 to 300 feet in length. They are awaiting shipment to some other part of the continent for the building of temples and palaces. Near the extinct volcanoes, Ranraraka and Ranarao are the remains of what was once a large stone temple. As the fallen stones lie, they outline a structure of about 100 feet long and 20 feet wide. Walls are still standing 5 feet high and 5 feet thick. Some of the stones of this structure have carved upon them figures which were the sacred symbols used in the first religion of man. W.J. Thompson. There are in existence about 7 tablets, all that are left of a vast number, bearing the written story of Easter Island. Thompson, with the aid of an old native, the only one on the island who knew the meaning of the glyphs on these tablets, deciphered and translated some of them. Herewith is Thompson's translation of 2. Tablet 1. When this island was first created and became known to our forefathers, the land was crossed with roads beautifully paved with flat stones. These stones were laid together so nicely that no rough edges were exposed. Coffee, mistranslation, trees were growing close to together along the borders of the road. They met overhead, and their branches were laced together like muscles. Heke was the builder of the roads, and it was he who sat in the place of honor, where the roads branched away in every direction. In that happy land, that beautiful land where Romaha formerly lived with his beloved Hangarva, Turaki used to listen to the voices of the birds and feed them. In that beautiful land governed the gods from heaven who lived in the waters when it was cold. There the black and white pointed spider would have mounted to heaven, but he was held back by the bitterness of the cold. Remains of these roads are to be seen on Easter and many other of the South Sea Islands. Tablet 2, entitled The Great King. What power has the Great King on land? He has the power to make the plants grow and to change the color of the sky. All hail the power of the Great King, who makes us lenient to the young plants, to admire the different colors of the sky, and to behold the clouds that rise. All hail the power of the Great King, who enables us to appreciate the blessings of bright stars, the lowering clouds, the gentle dew, the falling rain, and the light of the sun and the moon. What power has the Great King on land? He has the power to populate the earth, to create both kings and subjects. All hail to the power of the Great King, who hath created the human beings, given authority to kings, and created loyal subjects. What power has the Great King? He has the power to create the lobsters, white bait, eels, apefish, and everything in the sea. What power has the Great King over the seas? He hath the power to create the mighty fish that swim in deep water. All hail the power of the Great King, who enables us to withstand the attacks of the maggots, flies, worms, fleas, and all manner of insects. A legend tells the following. This little island had once been a part of a great continent of land, crossed with many roads, beautifully paved with flat stones. The roads were cunningly constructed to represent the plan of the web of the gray and black pointed spider, and no man could discover the beginning or the end therefor. W.J. Thompson. At the south end of the island, there are from 80 to 100 stone houses built in a regular line against a terrace of rock or earth, which in some cases form the back walls of the building. The walls of these peculiar houses average 5 feet in thickness and 4.5 feet in height. They are 4.5 feet broad and 13 feet long. The doorways are tiny affairs, not more than 20 inches high and 19 inches wide. The walls are formed by layers of irregular stones. These latter are often painted red, white, and black, showing birds, faces, and figures. Near the houses, the rocks of the banks of the sea cliff are carved in strange shapes, resembling human faces, tortoises, birds, fishes, and mythical animals. The history of Easter Island, since the white man discovered it, forms one long scene of tragedies. Cook Group. The Cook Group of Islands lies directly south of Hawaii, about 40 degrees. It is also about halfway between Tahiti and Fiji, but south of a direct line, I shall note 2 islands of this group. Rarotonga Island. On this island, there is a small section of the road referred to in the Easter Island tablet and legend, Mangaia Island. This is the southernmost island of the Cook group and about half the size of Easter Island. On it are remains similar to those on Easter Island, as there are no quarries or evidence of their being chiseled on the island. It is presumable that they were brought here. Tonga Tabu. Tonga Tabu is a coral atoll belonging to the Tonga group. There is not a particle of natural stone upon it, nothing but corals. Here on this patch of coral, we find an immense stone monument set up in the form of an arch. It consists of two huge uprights weighing about 70 tons each, which are bound together at the top of another stone weighing about 25 tons. There being no native stone on the island, and the nearest available stone being over 200 miles away, it leaves open a wide field for speculation as to what sort of ships the ancients had to carry such enormous weights, how they landed them from the ships, and what contrivances they had set up. They had to set them up in place as we now find them after they had been safely landed. The Gilbert and Marshall groups. On several of the islands composing these two groups are found tall, slender pyramids built of stone. The natives used the sacred symbols of the motherland as ornamentations, without knowing how they obtained the designs or their meanings. I have shown a prominent ornamentation from Orori Island, the fan of Princess Arawali with the royal escutcheon of Mu. The Caroline group. As regards prehistoric remains, nowhere throughout the Pacific Ocean are there to be found such astounding ruins as on the Caroline Islands. An added interest is that they lie one moon's journey towards the rising sun from Burma, where according to the Nikkal tablets and Valmiki, the motherland of man once stood, the spot whence came the first settlers in Burma and India. Panape. On Panape stands what I consider to be the most important ruin in the South Sea Islands. It consists of the ruins of a great temple, a structure 300 feet long by 60 feet wide, with walls still standing in 1874, 30 feet high, and at the ground 5 feet in thickness. On the walls are the remains of carvings of many of the sacred symbols of the motherland. This temple is connected with canals and earthworks, and has vaults, passages, and platforms. The whole is built of basaltic stone. Below the pavements of the great quadrangle, on opposite sides, are two passages or gateways, each about 10 feet square. These are pierced through the outer wall with passageways leading down to the canal. Within the great quadrangle is a central pyramidal chamber, unquestionably the Holy of Holies. According to the natives, many generations ago, this temple was occupied for a time by the shipwrecked crew of a Spanish buccaneer. Relics of these outlaws are still being found in one of the vaults which they used as a storehouse. The natives cannot be induced to go near the ruin because they say it is haunted by ghosts and evil spirits, which they call Maoli. Other ruins are also on Panape, some of them also to the seashore, others on tops of mounds or hills, or are to be found on cleared spaces toward the center of the island, but all command views on the ocean on one of the cleared spaces. There is a ruinous heap of stones covered between 5 and 6 acres. It is situated on a sort of tableland. Around it there appears to have been a ditch or a canal. At the corners, which are at the cardinal points, the ruins assume tall mounds, indicating by their various distribution that the building was square. To my mind, the various ruins of Panape are the ruins of one of the motherland's capital cities, one of the 7 sacred cities. It is impossible to estimate the population, but it must have been very large, 100,000 at least. Swallow Island, 120 east of Panape. On this small island is a pyramid of similar construction to that found on Guam and Tinian. On the west side of the island is a vast quadrangular enclosure of stone containing several mounds. Probably if the coverings of guano and soil were removed, edifices of some kind would be found. Kusai Island, southeast corner of the group. On this and the surrounding islands are found similar ruins to Panape, but not nearly so extensive. On the south side of the harbor of this latter island are several canals lined with stone. They cross each other at right angles. Between their intersections are artificially made islands, which originally had buildings on them. One tower still remaining is about 35 feet high. Native traditions of this island say the people who once lived there were very powerful. They had large vessels in which they made voyages far distant, east and west, taking many moons to complete a voyage. Does this not entirely agree with Valmiki when he says the Mayas were mighty navigators whose ships passed from the eastern to western oceans and from the southern to the northern sea? Lele Island is separated from Kusai Island by a narrow channel. On this island is a conical hill surrounded by a wall 18 or 20 feet high and of enormous thickness. The whole of this island represents a series of cyclopean enclosures and lines of great walls. Some of the enclosures are parallelograms 200 by 100 feet in extent. There is a very large one between 300 and 400 feet in length and over 150 feet wide. The walls generally are 12 feet thick, and within are vaults, artificial caverns, and secret passageways. The natives of this corner of the Carolines were extremely hostile to the white man and were cannibals of the worst description in 1874. Possibly they have been tamed down a bit since then. Kingsmill Islands. On the Tapito Island of this group are found the same tall, slender pyramids of stone as are found in the Gilbert and Marshall groups. Navigator Islands. On these islands are found great stone structures. On one of them there is a remarkable structure on the top of a 1,500-foot hill and near the edge of a precipice which has a sheer drop of 500 feet. The structure is a platform built of huge blocks of igneous stone. It is 150 feet in diameter and 20 feet high. On one side of this structure is the precipice and on the other a ditch, which originally might have been 18 or 20 feet deep. Ladrone or Mariana Group, Guam. The relics on these islands have a character of their own. They consist principally of solid stone, truncated pyramidal columns, usually about 20 feet high, including the hemispherical stone or capital, and 10 feet square at their bases. Some are capped with a stone hemispherical in shape. In other cases, these stones lie on the ground as if they had been taken off by seismic disturbance. On the island of Tinian, they are arranged in columns. Extract from article by Laren Targil. Three of the latter have fallen with their tassas still intact. Three are completely shattered, and the capitals of two lie as though shaken from their supports by some violent shudder of the earth. Shaped like truncated pyramids and capped by hemispherical stones, the pillars are 18 feet in circumference at the base, 11 feet high, and taper at the top to a little over 15 feet around, on which the capitals stand 5 feet high and 6 feet thick. Hewn from rough, hard, sedimentary rock, each monument weighs close to 30 tons, and the two parallel lines of columns, which originally stood 7 feet apart, formed a ground plan almost 54 feet long by 10.5 feet wide. Hawaii. About 30 miles from Hilo is a great ruin on a hill called Kuki'i. There are no stones on this hill except those which have been carried there. The summit was leveled and squared, and the building laid out according to the cardinal points and the floor paved. Two square blocks of stone in an upright position about 15 or 16 feet apart range exactly east and west. The upper part of the hill was terraced, and the terraces had been faced with hewn stone. The stones were perfect squares, the smallest 3 feet in diameter, while others were larger. Every stone was faced and polished on all sides so that they could perfectly fit together. There is still about 30 feet of facing left on the lower terrace, partly in position. On the western side, there was a stairway running from the base to the top of the hill, a height of nearly 300 feet. On Kona is another ruin. The Marquesas. There are several noteworthy ruins on the Marquesan Islands. Apparently, no one has ever felt inclined to make an examination of them. I believe the fact that they are there has never before been published. The foregoing is a long list of Titanic stone remains, and yet I have not enumerated one half of what are to be found on the South Sea Islands. From this evidence, the logical mind can form only one conclusion, and that is, at one time in the Earth's history, there was a great continent of land in the Pacific Ocean, which embraced all of the groups of islands where prehistoric remains are to be found. This great continent had an exceedingly high civilization. That continent was Mu, the motherland of man. That her name was Mu and her geographical position are attested by the records of India, Uyghur, Egypt, Mayaks, Peru, and of the cliff dwellers of North America. These cyclopean remains are her pathetic, withered fingers that refuse to go down with her broken back and mangled body. New Zealand. The Maoris, natives of New Zealand, are rich in legends and traditions of the dim past. Many of the ancient sacred symbols are also found among them. The most prominent is the tat, or totem pillar, which they erect at the entrance of their villages. In employing the name tat, I am employing the Egyptian. These pillars were used by the Mayans, Incas, Atlanteans, Egyptians, Chaldeans, and other ancient peoples. The meaning of the tat, or totem pillar, is given in my section on the ancient sacred symbols. Australia. Australia appears to be particularly bare of ancient records, legends, and traditions, and this is not to be wondered at if my geological deductions about Australia are correct. Geometrical figures have been found rudely carved on some of the boomerangs of the northern tribes. An Australian cave painting has been found which, without doubt, antedates... There are three remarkable objects in the painting. The first is Ra, the sun, and the second, the numeral 3, symbol of Mu, shown twice, and the third, an axe. When the English first settled in Australia, axes of any description were unknown to the natives. I have never heard of any legends or traditions having been found among the native Australians. After deciphering and translating the symbols found carved on the stones of the ancient Polynesian remains of the temples and statuary, and in the quarries among the unfinished work, I felt at the time that among the South Sea Islands, and especially in the division called Polynesia, traditions might be found that would prove of the greatest value in connecting the past civilization of the South Sea Islands with a civilization of a later date, of which we have at least some fragmentary records. The great stone mountains existing among the South Sea Islands have always been a puzzle to ethnologists. All have been convinced that there must have been a great civilization there, and then the shadow of time that has become darkness, the new day, the beginning, as civilization now calls it, dawned thereafter. Assumptions have been made that the white Polynesians came down from the original white race, and it seems to be supported by records and traditions found in various parts of the earth. Mexico, Central America, India, and Egypt. In Central America and Mexico, there are traditions stating that the first people who inhabited those countries were a white race. The Mayas of Mayaks, those who built the great edifices whose ruins now dot the land, were a white race. Temple inscriptions in Yucatan say they came there from lands that lay to the west of America. Polynesian lies to the west of America. The Guatemalan tradition also shows the white race advancing to the east from America. Hindu records tell us that the central parts of India, the Deccan, were first colonized by a white race called Mayas, who came to India via Burma, and that their motherland was one moon's journey towards the rising sun, east of Burma. Polynesia lies to the east of Burma. It is thus shown that those coming to America came from the west, and those coming to India came from the east. This is conclusive evidence that the original home of the white race was a land that lay geographically between America and Asia. Among these people, I find a tradition of the creation corresponding in all material details with that of the ancients throughout the world. Ellis, Polynesian Researches, Volume 1, page 100. In the Sandwich Islands, Hawaii, there is a tradition that in the beginning there was nothing but water. When a big bird descended from on high and laid an egg in the sea, the egg burst and Hawaii came forth. This is the cosmogony of all the ancients. All say water covered the face of the earth and that life started from a cosmic egg laid in the sea. Samoa. The Samoans have a tradition that in the beginning the whole earth was covered with water. The flood. O'Brien says in Mystic Isles of the South Seas, in most of Polynesia there are legends of a universal flood from which but a few escaped. Adam and Eve. The Polynesians had very fixed ideas upon the origin of the universe and man. Hawaii. Taroa made out of red earth Aria and breathed into his nostrils. He made woman from man's bones and called her Ivi. In the Polynesian language, Ivi is pronounced Ivi. Cain and Abel. A Tonga tradition states that the son of the first man killed his brother. New Zealand. A tradition of the Maori states that the son of the first man killed his brother. Tower of Babel. In Fiji is still shown the site where a vast tower was built because the Fijians were curious and wanted to peep into the moon to discover if it was inhabited. Polynesian cosmogony. Tahiti. Taroa, whose name was spelled differently in separate archipelagos, was the father of Tahitian cosmogony. His wife was Hina, the earth, and his son Oro was the ruler of the world. Tane, the Hawaiian god, was a brother of Oro and his equal. This corresponds with the cosmogony of the most ancient, namely a trinity or a triune godhead. Mystic forces. During the time of the earth's first civilization, many abstruse sciences were known which today are not known. They have been lost between the two civilizations. The adepts of the ancient could walk through fire without being scorched, as related in the Bible and Popol Vuh. There is reliable testimony that South Pacific Islanders have been known to walk barefooted on red-hot stones without being burnt. The same thing has been witnessed in Hawaii, and I have personally seen it done in the Fiji Islands. A few years since, a report was made that in Samoa the blind were made to see through their flesh. The report was sneered at by scientists, and the public generally looked upon it as a newspaper story, a traveler's lie. The following from the New York World, reporting from Paris, the accomplishment of the same phenomena answers, I think, the scientific sneers that were handed out when the report came from the savages of Samoa. This article is as follows. Not only have you eyes in the back of your head, but your body is simply covered with them, and they can all be used if trained properly. This conclusion is reached by several scientists here who have witnessed experiments by Jules Romain, writer of a book on the subject. They contend with M. Romain that just beneath the skin are os cells, microscopic organs united to the central nervous system, and that these are dormant eyes. M. Romain, it is claimed, has succeeded in training a number of persons to use these eyes effectively. They can distinguish colors and read while heavily blindfolded. Some can see with cheeks and fingers, some with their noses. One subject was able to distinguish a hat 4 yards away. These results, it is asserted, are accomplished after the subject has been placed in a state of great mental concentration, not allied to hypnotism. While the first experiment is not apt to show much result, second tests have shown in some subjects an ability to read playing cards blindfolded after 3 hours of concentration. The ability of the subject, it is said, improves with each succeeding test. Thus, it is now demonstrated that the blind can be made to see through the skin. But the Samoan practiced it thousands of years ago. The foregoing traditions and legends are astounding, and at first glance must stagger one, for here among those who have been shut off from the outside world up to within 300 years, and most of them within 200 years, we are met with the fact that they have among themselves legends and traditions about the creation and the early history of man that are identical with the legends and traditions found in the Bible. Greece. A few references to the motherland of man are to be found among the writings of the old Greek philosophers. In the year 403 BC, during the archonship of Euclid, the Greek grammarians rearranged the Athenian alphabet in its present form. The Greek alphabet today is composed of Maya vocables forming an epic that relates the destruction of Mu. The translation of the Greek alphabet is as follows. The Greek alphabet. The alphabet of the Greeks is an epic composed of Kara Maya vocables and is a commemorative memorial to their forefathers who lost their lives at the destruction of Mu. In Plato's Timaeus Critias we find this reference to the lost continent. The land of Mu had 10 peoples. Proclus wrote, "The lands of the West had 10 peoples." Here we find two of the old Greek philosophers writing about the motherland of man. One uses its hieratical name, the other its geographical name, but both assert that there were 10 separate peoples. Straight reading. Heavily break the waters over the plains. They cover the low places where there are obstructions, shores form. The earth is stuck with water. The waters spread on all that gives and moves. The foundations give way, and submerged is the land of Mu. The peaks only appear above the water. Whirlwinds blow around until gradually comes cold air. Before there existed valleys are great depths, cold tanks. In particular places, mud banks formed. A mouth opens, out of which vapors pour forth, and volcanic sediments. The Greek alphabet written in the hieratic characters. This is written to read from left to right. The ancients generally wrote to read from right to left when the writing was in horizontal lines. Origin of the Greek cross. The Greek cross is, as it is known, has always been an enigma and a puzzle to scientists on account of it being found in so many inscriptions which are unreadable to our archaeologists. It appears in inscriptions in Yucatan and Central America especially. Winter, in his work Guatemala, page 156, says, "The mysterious symbol of the Greek cross, which has also been found on the stones of Quirigua and Copan, has been the cause of much speculation among scholars. No one apparently can solve the simple problem." The Greek cross, figure 1. As the central figure of the royal escutcheon of Mu, the empire of the sun, the hieroglyph is a phrase in the mother tongue of Mu, meaning U-Lumil, pronounced U-Lu-Umil. Translated into English, it is the land of, the country of, and by extension the empire of, or the kingdom of, so that in all of these inscriptions where it appears, it represents one of the foregoing phrases, depending on what comes before and what comes after it. The Greek cross confirms the accuracy of my deciphering of the Greek alphabet. The Greek alphabet confirms the accuracy of my deciphering of the cross, and the two confirm the existence of Mu, the empire of the sun, and that she was the motherland of the Greeks. Chapter 5, The Egyptian Sacred Volume, Book of the Dead. In the preceding chapter, I have referred to the Egyptian Book of the Dead. It contains many records that prove the motherland of man, the submerged continent of Mu, to have indeed been the original habitat of mankind, and that other countries were merely orbits for bodies that moved about a center of attraction, the highly civilized continent of Mu, colonizer of worlds that lay beyond its immediate ken. Consequently, it does not appear to me to be out of place to say that at this point a few words about the Book of the Dead. The Book of the Dead is the common name by which this sacred volume is known. In Egyptian hieroglyphics, the name is written Per Emhru. According to Egyptologists, Per means coming forth, Hru means day, and M is a preposition meaning from. But Egyptologists are not all in accord on the exact meaning of the title of this book. Dr. Fleite, in his Cafetris Supplementaires du Libre de Mort, says the name should be read Going Forth from the Day. Bruch Bey, in his Steinschrift und Bibelwort, page 257, maintains that the correct meaning is Book of the Outgoing by Day. Lefebvre, Maspero, and Renou say the reading is Coming Forth by Day. While these great Egyptologists are in dispute, who shall say which is correct? The only way the problem can be solved, it appears to me, is to show what the book actually refers to and what it actually means. For all the writings composing it are symbolical, and it is necessary to know what they symbolize. This has not been shown by an Egyptologist up to the present time. The Book of the Dead is a sacred memorial dedicated to the multitudes of people who lost their lives at the destruction of Mu, the forefathers of the Egyptians, and all mankind. These are the dead referred to. This feeling of love and devotion to the motherland, this feeling of love and respect for forefathers, is the origin of ancestor worship, so common throughout the world in past and present ages. Have we not a reflection of it among ourselves? Do we not lay flowers on the graves of those who have passed away? I entirely disagree with all Egyptologists on the meaning of Per Emhru. Per means gone forth, Hru means the day, and Em means Mu. The letter M, which Egyptologists term a preposition, is nothing of the kind. It is a symbol, the symbolic letter, and also the name of Mu. Therefore, Per Emhru reads, Mu has gone forth from the day. This is in accord with what I have previously said. The Book of the Dead is a sacred memorial to 64 million people who lost their lives at the destruction of Mu. My years of study in the Orient with some of the most capable of Oriental scholars have enabled me to read many of the esoteric meanings appearing in the Book of the Dead, for it must be remembered that there is a close connection between the ancient learning of India and that of Egypt. Upper Egypt was colonized and settled by Mayas from India, and when their settlement Mayu was firmly established, a party of Nikals left India and went to Egypt to establish the teachings of the seven sacred inspired writings, religion, and the sciences. Thus it is seen that the teachings I received in India to an extent applied also to Egypt. At what date the Book of the Dead was first formed is unknown. Apparently, however, the first copies contained only a few chapters, which were subsequently added to until it assumed the proportions which we now find it. In this respect, it has been a duplication of the Hindu book Mahabharata, which commenced small and grew large with time. Every chapter in the Book of the Dead either directly or indirectly refers to Mu, and the book is permeated with symbols which were assigned to Mu before the foot of man trod the soil of Egypt. As stated, Mu was first torn to pieces by earthquakes and then sunk through the flames of the underneath into a fiery abyss or cauldron. I shall now take a few vignettes from the Book of the Dead, decipher and translate them, to show the connection between the Book of the Dead and Mu, the motherland. Vignette 1. This is an Egyptian compound symbol, or vignette describing Mu's destruction, found in the Book of the Dead. 1. Is the Egyptian symbol for flames of fire. 2. Is the hieratic letter M of the motherland and her alphabetical and geometrical symbol, and one of the most commonly used symbols for her. 3. Is an ancient symbol depicting an abyss, a tank, or a pit. 4. Is this tank or abyss filled with fire? Thus the vignette reads, Mu has gone down into an abyss of fire, and as she sank, flames of fire shot up around her and enveloped her. This is told by flames being set all around. Figure 2, Mu. One of the most prominent symbols, on account of its being so oft repeated, is a conventional altar over which is a set sun, and above the sun, a dead closed lotus. This compound symbol is found scores of times among the vignettes of the Book of the Dead, and a notable fact is that the lotus is invariably depicted as dead and closed throughout the book. I will decipher and translate this little vignette. 1. Is the Egyptian conventional form of an altar. 2. Is the sacred lotus flower, the sacred floral symbol of Mu. 3. Is the sun without rays, symbolizing that the sun has set, gone down beyond the horizon, being placed below Mu. The lotus, it symbolizes that the sun has dropped below the horizon of Mu. The sun has forever set on dead Mu. All is darkness. Mu is in the region of darkness. Before the submersion of Mu, her common geographical symbol was a three-pointed figure, reading the lands of the west, the three areas of land which compose the motherland. After Mu was submerged, her geographical location was called the region of darkness, and in this condition she was symbolized by placing a sun without rays over the center point. Occasionally the center point was cut out altogether and a rayless sun substituted. The vignette of chapter 81 in the Book of the Dead, Egyptologists have deciphered this vignette as a head peeping out of a lotus flower. The last line of the 81st chapter reads, I am a pure lotus sprung out of the field of the sun. The deciphering of this vignette is, the head represents an Egyptian and Egyptians as shown by the headdress. The head has arisen out of a lotus. The lotus is shown as dead and closed. In this vignette, the lotus is dead Mu. Translated, it reads, "The Egyptians came from Mu, a land which is dead and exists no more." The last line is the crux of the whole chapter. "I am a pure lotus" means, "I am a pure descendant from the people of Mu." "Sprung from the field of the sun" corroborates the lotus. The field of the sun also means the empire of the sun, the imperial name of Mu. Mu in the tongue of the motherland meant motherland, field, country, empire, and mouth. A free reading of this vignette would be, "I am an Egyptian of pure descent. My forefathers came from the motherland Mu, the empire of the sun, which is now dead and gone." Space will not permit me to decipher more vignettes from the Book of the Dead. A large volume could be filled with them. I will make one more note, which is all Egyptian, but only partially from the Book of the Dead. All ancient peoples, including the Egyptians, believed in the reincarnation of the soul. Our old Oriental tablets showed us that the ancients understood the origin and the workings of all the forces. They knew that when a force had done its allotted duty, that which had been assigned to it by nature, it became exhausted, but not dead. A force cannot die any more than an element can die. An exhausted force is drawn back to the source of generation for regeneration, then to be passed into nature's storehouse, there to await the next call from nature. This is what the old tablets tell us. Man's soul is the greatest force connected with the earth except that of the deity. The soul of man was incarnated in the land of Mu, the lands of the West. When man's body sleeps its last sleep and decomposes, his soul does not die with the body, but the ancients believed returns to the place of incarnation, Mu, there to await reincarnation. From the time of Menes, when Upper and Lower Egypt became one kingdom, down to about 2700 BC, there were two religious cults in Egypt, known as the West Cult and the East Cult. The belief of the Lower Egyptians was that the soul traveled west to reach the place of reincarnation. The Upper Egyptians claimed that the soul must travel east to reach a celestial paradise. Both cults claimed that the soul must travel back over the same road to the place of reincarnation by which their forefathers came to Egypt. When looking at the foregoing and reading the speculations of professional Egyptologists concerning these diametric cults, one is tempted to smile, for I have failed to find a single Egyptian authority who explains the origin and cause of these two cults, which at one time existed in Egypt, yet the problem is easy to answer, as the following will prove. Lower Egypt was settled from the motherland via Myax and Atlantis, both of which lay to the west of Egypt. Therefore, to reach the place of reincarnation from Lower Egypt and to travel back over the same road by which their fathers came, the soul had to travel back to the west. The Upper Egyptians came to Egypt from the motherland by way of Burma and India. Both of these countries lie to the east of Egypt, so that for the souls of the Upper Egyptians to arrive at the place of reincarnation and to travel back over the same road by which their fathers came, they had to travel back to the east. So it is seen that both cults were right, although it took them many hundreds of years to find it out. Donald A. McKenzie. The fusion of the two ancient Egyptian cults, that of Osiris, which were originally believed in a paradise in the west, and that of the sun worshippers, who believed in a celestial paradise in the east. Osiris, an ancient deified king, was identified with the gods of the western cult. The early conflict between the two cults is echoed in the mortuary texts dating back till about 2700 BC. Like all Egyptologists, McKenzie is sadly deficient in symbology. All fail to differentiate between the symbol and what it represents. They fail to remember that the ancients used a special symbol for every attribute of the deity, and that the sun was the collective symbol of all the attributes of the deity, and therefore represented by the deity himself. The Upper Egyptians were not sun worshippers, as stated by McKenzie. Ra, the sun, was their collective symbol for the deity. Temples were dedicated to Ra as representing the divinity, just as the cross today represents Christ. A symbol is an intimate reminder, mentally concentrating and bringing in closer touch and mental view the object addressed, which the use of symbols, many encroaching thoughts are driven away. A symbol permits of greater concentration. McKenzie asserts that Osiris was an ancient king. What people he reigned over, Mackenzie does not say, but by inference, it would be the Egyptians. If so, he is wrong again, because when Thoth started the first lower Egyptian colony at Sais, he taught the Osirian religion, as various papyri show, and that was 16,000 years ago. From two different sources, I find it stated that Osiris lived in Atlantis 18,000 or 20,000 years ago, and that he was a great religious teacher, a master. The two Egyptian cults from another convincing proof that the advent of man on Earth was of Mu, and that Mu was situated in the Pacific. The geographical position is thus positively established as east of Burma and west of Myax, and therefore in the Pacific Ocean. The destruction of the motherland was also commemorated in their religious ceremonies. The advancement of the novice through the second degree was by symbolically submerging him in a tank of fire to remind him of the fate that befell his forefathers in the beloved motherland, and also to hint there was where his soul must go for reincarnation. This is reflected in the Book of the Dead, chapter 22, where it says, "I come, I do that which my heart wishes on the day of the fire, when I extinguish the flames as soon as they appear."